All right, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. This is Mike DiBiase again, coming at you from Body Track, and we are presenting you another webinar here. Every month we try to bring you a new webinar, a new discussing point on nutrition and human performance, and we are going to talk today on two different diets and, of course, their effects on health and performance. As always, we want to make sure you guys...
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome again. Mike DiBiase here. We are going to bring you guys this great webinar today from Body Track. We just had a little bit of a mess up. Forgot to hit one of the buttons, but we're going to start it over. We are bringing these to you guys every month with some new topic, and we are going to try to give you guys some information on different nutritional ideas and programs, diets, supplements, anything that is going to help improve your life and your performance, and give you a little bit of knowledge in your own life so you can make the most informed decision. Again, we don't advocate doing anything specific or things that you have to do or have to change. We are bringing you some of the most up-to-date current knowledge as best as possible and give you the most information to make the best decision and most informed decision that you can make for your own health and performance. So if you have any questions, please feel free to bring them in or send them to Body Track, and we'll be glad to answer them as they come through. Today we're going to be talking about two different diets and their effects on your health and performance. We'll be going over some studies that have been done and just ways to possibly modify them if these are diets that you are currently doing or want to do, and we'll spend the next hour kind of going over them. So to begin, let's go over quickly what is dieting. So if you Google search it, you'll get it as a verb or noun, and basically we take into account the term dieting as to restrict oneself to small amounts or special kinds of food in order to lose weight. And that is a very simple term to consider for dieting. That's a term that most of us, if not all, think about dieting, but that's also not it's a very small realm of the term diet, and we're going to be talking a little bit about weight loss and the ideas behind reduced calorie intake, but we also don't want to automatically assume the word diet means to lose, because sometimes there is a negative stigma with the word diet. Some of us go on specific health-related diets where we have to maintain or optimize our current health. Some of us go on diets for performance reasons. Some of us go on diets to lose weight, for future health benefits. So there's many reasons, but the truth is we all diet no matter what. Just your regular food intake at home may actually be a diet for someone else who may be over-consuming calories, or your current diet, your current food intake at home may be considered overconsumption for someone who's eating a lot less. So when somebody says they're dieting, just assume that everybody is dieting, just maybe not as strict as you or maybe not as strict as someone else. But for this lecture, we're going to focus on the term as diet for reduction of weight and or fat mass, change to body composition, change to performance, enhanced performance. We never want to get on a diet that's going to reduce performance. There's no point to that, because remember, life is performance. We want to perform well and better in everything we do. So if we're doing a diet that is restricting or interfering with that, that's not a good, sustainable diet. So in 2011, there was a Gallup poll titled, "To Lose Weight, Americans Rely More on Dieting Than Exercise." And one of the statements in it was, "Americans who have succeeded at losing weight at some point in their lives, 52% of all U.S. adults, a little bit over half, more likely to mention diet changes than exercise as their strategies to lose weight, essentially." But exercising 31%, roughly, eating less about 23%. Again, these are Gallup polls, so they're talking to the masses, getting more observational and anecdotal references, specifically lead the individual responses. So The number one, of course, is dieting, and then you got, of course, exercising. So here was the 2011 Gallup poll with the percentages and the dietary changes and how they went through the actual changes and what was accounted for. So, of course, ate less and dieted. No specific diet, just essentially ate less and went on a calorie restriction. 23% mentioned that that's how they used it to lose weight. Counted calories and portion control, so sometimes that may also be considered part of a if it fits your macros style diet. Ate more natural foods, and some people actually get a secondary mechanism of losing weight when they eat more natural foods, that overly processed foods have sometimes have a higher caloric intake and a lower nutrient density, which means that they may overeat some of those foods. So more natural foods tend to be more nutrient dense, tend to fill us up a little bit more, maybe because of the fibers and the natural lean proteins and the better, healthier fats. So more naturally may also just be a natural calorie restriction without actually restricting calories. And avoiding sugar, sweets, and sodas have helped some people. So as you go down the list, you guys can look at this later. But essentially, dietary changes, reduction in calories was the number one response. Obesity and overweight in America. So we know obesity using the BMI scale is 30 or greater, and that is kilograms and meters squared, heights meters squared. If you look down where it says more than two-thirds, roughly 69% of adults are considered to be overweight. So overweight is 25 on the BMI scale, up to 29.9. And then almost a third, 35.7, about 36% of adults are considered to be obese. Again, BMI 30 or greater. The Journal of American Medicine also states that about 35% of U.S. adults are obese. So we have two different references stating approximately the same number. And the money that goes into obesity and the prevention, or I guess the diagnosis and the medicine for obesity, may vastly outweigh the prevention of obesity. So we want to look at diets that are preventative and healthy rather than are just strictly elimination and after the fact, after we get diagnosed, after something negative happens, and now we have to go on. Sometimes the best diets are the preventative diets that increase performance and increase health overall. Reasons why we diet. This list is not absolute and is, of course, not exhausted, but there's many different reasons, and I'm sure maybe one or more of these reasons affects you if you are trying to lose weight or in a calorie reductive state. Improved overall health should be one of the main reasons. We always want to be safe, we always want to be healthy. So if we are dieting, we have to do it in the most healthy and safest way possible for the best long-term effects. To quote unquote look and feel better, there is an aesthetic change, and there is that sense of self-worth that comes with doing things that improve the way we look, the way we feel. To be considered more normal, unfortunately, we look at normalcy as being thin and fit, where a lot of people may be considered overweight or obese with their specific BMI, but they also may be professional football players. So we can't always use BMI as our determinant. We have to use fat mass and fat free mass, which is muscle, and of course their fitness levels to determine what we would consider normal, what we consider best for us individually. Pressure from the media, the social stigma of being overweight or obese or unfit, and the peer pressure from around us when we go out to restaurants with friends and we feel that we can't eat certain foods, if we're around family who may be suffering from obesity or families who are overweight and we don't have that good family support, we may turn into a downward spiral where we may not be eating appropriately or eating in the wrong direction, which could lead to vastly more negative outcomes than just weight loss. body composition changes. Some people want to change their body composition again to look and feel better for competitions. Some athletes do it to actually improve their performance. Not every athlete needs to change their body composition, but some athletes like to say that their reduced fat mass and increased muscle mass and being more toned and shredded makes them better athletes. And for some, that is true. For others, it isn't. Enhanced performance. Some diets can enhance performance. You know, if one athlete is over consuming carbs and fats and without actually utilizing them as fuel, and the other person is having a much more balanced diet, more than likely the one with the balanced diet, all things up, everything else being equal, should theoretically perform better. So diet does have to take into account when we're looking at increased performance. Longevity. We all want to live not just longer, but better and healthier and longer. A long, bad life is not good. We don't want to live just long and survive. We want to live long and actually live. So a diet should provide longevity and increased happiness as long as we possibly can live. And of course, financial, spiritual, economical, and all the other environmental reasons why we try to diet. Some of us like to diet and change the way we eat based on trying to eat more local. Some diet because we have to. We don't may not have the funds to eat certain foods. Different spiritual and religious reasons like Ramadan during fasting. Certain religious aspects don't allow certain foods to be eaten at all. So there's many reasons, but at least one of these reasons applies to most people, if not all. There are many, many choices for different diets, but the two that we're going to hit on today, there are many popular diets. We could spend hours and days talking about each one, and none of them will get us anywhere, but these two tend to be in the news the most. One, we've heard constantly, the paleo diet, the paleolithic diet, the caveman diet, however we want to phrase it. And then one that some of you may not know, the low-carb, high-fat, also known as a ketogenic diet. We'll go over that. Each of them have their own pros and cons, benefits and pitfalls, medical reasons, health reasons, performance reasons. And we'll go over them so you guys can make the most informed decision and see how they relate to your current diet. So we'll start with the paleo diet. So a lot of people have called it the caveman diet because in theory and some research, whether it's actual research or anecdotal or just perceived to be true, a lot of people believe that millions of years ago, our Paleolithic ancestors ate a certain way, more lean meats and fish, more fruits and veggies as abundant as they would have been in that specific area or region of where our Paleolithic ancestor would have lived, different berries and nuts. And as you can see, the base of the pyramid in the paleo pyramid is lean meats and fish, grass-fed, as wild and as natural as possible of all the foods. Same thing with veggies, as natural as possible, no processed foods. You can see there's no dairy on this pyramid. You can see that there's no legumes. And as we get further and further up, it gets less and less and less. So berries aren't necessarily put with the fruit, as you can see, that even though a lot of berries may be considered fruit. And then nuts are at the top of the list being the least amount eaten. So this is much different than the normal food pyramid that we would have seen, where the base would have been the grains, the pastas. Here it's lean meats and fish. It was actually the popular diet in the world in 2013, and popular at least known, tried, researched. Maybe not everybody in the world or the majority of people in the world were doing this particular diet, but it may have been at least most popular in being known around communities and being researched and being at least studied and talked about. We cannot confuse the paleo diet with paleo for athletes. That is a little bit different. There are some different tangents about when fruit can be eaten and so forth. So we're not going to get into those specifics. We're just going to talk about the general paleo diet and what they believe or and perceive should be eaten and things that shouldn't be eaten. If you look on the chart, the okay to eats, and this list isn't exhaustive, but it gives a general background of fruits, vegetables, lean meats, seafood, nuts and seeds, and healthy fats, and things to avoid: dairy, grains, processed foods and processed sugars, legumes, starches, and alcohol. Well, we can definitely say the processed foods and processed sugars, that's a good call. More overly processed food, if we can even call that food these days anyways, should be limited or avoided as much as possible. Alcohol, as good as it is sometimes, should be limited as much as possible. We don't get good sustainable energy, and we get more negative outcomes from overconsumption of alcohol than we do get positives, of course. But the avoidance of dairy and grains and legumes and starches is controversial for a lot of people. There's a lot of research that says removing grains, removing dairy at least, really reduces the amount of specific minerals and vitamins that are going to be consumed, which could put somebody at a deficit or insufficient levels. But also, you have other people on the other side saying, well, dairy can cause inflammatory response. So removing dairy can have that anti-inflammatory aspect. So there's always two sides of the coin, always two sides of the conversation. So it's up to you to do the research and find out what applies to you individually. It can actually make it hard for people to enjoy eating. And really, when it comes down to, some of us eat because we feel we have to eat this, and we don't enjoy it anymore. And eating really is an enjoyable experience. We should enjoy the food, and it should be really as healthy and as beneficial as possible, at least the majority and most of the time. But we should enjoy every bite we take. So for some people, it's not an enjoyable process over a long time. So is that a sustainable diet? Is that something that somebody can stay on for years and years and years if they're not reaping the benefits and they're not actually enjoying themselves doing it? The claim for paleo is you're going to lead a better, healthier, more naturally and fit life with a lower risk of disease. And a lot of research, there has been some risk, a lowered risk of disease. Risk markers have been reduced and lowered, but a lot of these studies are very short term. We're talking 3 days to maybe 12 weeks. So much more research is needed, and long term studies are needed. Theory is that the highly processed, carb heavy eating that is typical of an American diet have, of course, been some of the biggest contributors to the health crisis that we're seeing today, especially with obesity being a major source of some of the diseases. And that is not untrue. We can definitely say the overly processed, overconsumption of specific foods, stepping away from the more natural, wholesome foods, has contributed to some degree to the obesity epidemic. Now, does this mean removing these carbs immediately and almost completely is the most beneficial? Again, depending on what you're doing, who you are, and how well you're able to maintain this particular diet. A lot of the advocates for paleo, we should eat the way humans did during the days of hunter and gather, just like 10,000 BC. Essentially, plant, animal proteins, foraging as best as possible. But some research that is coming out is showing that that may not have been the case. This is from Brian St. Pierre. He's one of the nutritionists for Precision Nutrition. If you are not familiar with Precision Nutrition, I suggest you take a look at them. Really great stuff from Dr. John Berardi up in Canada, and they're a very well-organized nutrition and fitness program. Paleolithic versus today, so their defense is fruits were different. The produce to this day has, of course, been selectively bred. We can bring corn from one state and then corn from another, and they could be two genetically very diverse bits of corn based on where they've been bred, based on the type of breeding, how long those different breeding patterns have occurred. Different cultivars have been created. the wild game, no domestication, and of course the foods are just not the same. If we go back 10,000, 20,000 BC up to today, it's very hard to say that, oh yeah, these foods are completely the same, these foods lasted this long. And as we have evolved, we have changed our dietary patterns to reflect our environment. So it's really difficult to say that Paleolithic caveman ate a specific way without us really knowing the way things were back then and without really knowing those diet plans. So that's where a lot of the research now is coming to say that they may not have been those typical quote unquote meat eaters and planters. They may have been more vegetarians, if anything. So more research is needed to actually figure out what the paleo diet is, but according to what the advocates and what the believers of paleo, this is what they are stating as of today. One convergence that has happened in the last few years is paleo with CrossFit, and we've seen it a lot. CrossFit is what it is. It's a high intense, relatively high volume, quick ballistic movement pattern style workout. For some people, they absolutely love it. Other people have ridiculed it and said it's dangerous. We won't be getting into that, but we have definitely seen a lot of CrossFitters stick with the paleo diet for improved performance, improved body composition, and whatever it is that they're looking for. So these two have gone hand in hand in the last few years. It is a high energy workout, and it really pushes the body to its limits. Not every time, but most of the time. And we've seen the CrossFit Games, how intense they can be, and the type of workouts and exercises that they do. Some of us do those exercises a lot slower in a lot more controlled manner, but CrossFit is the way it is. So, as we've known through different other webinars that we have done and different talks, the one thing that kind of stands out that some dietitian nutritionists are trying to make more clear is that we know that carbs are pretty much the easiest of the three macronutrients to process for energy. We call it ATP. It will give us the fastest rate of the three macronutrients of ATP production, the fastest rate. Not necessarily the most, but at least, but the fastest rate, of course. So if we need that energy at the fastest rate, at the quickest time frame, and we are limiting that carbohydrate intake, essentially what we're asking is, where's that energy going to come from? So now this gets into smaller other conversations of the timing of the carbohydrates in the paleo diet, if there are any. Some people are a little bit more liberal on their paleo diet. Some people are very strict on it. So if you're limiting carbohydrate intake, how are you timing out that fuel source so you will have the most optimum workout and exercise program, and also able to replenish your glycogen stores after you have had such a hard workout? Anecdotally, basically, people talking to other people and getting information from those conversations, so those people have claimed to have more energy, which can be true, and that can come from essentially the cleaner eating, the minimization or the removal of processed foods, eating more organic, more natural, more nutrient-dense food choices. It can also be essentially coming from the placebo effect of being mentally challenged and having that idea of that something is changing and being happy about it, having that quick burst of energy and having that. Your mind, you basically say, this is something new, this is something good, this is something that's better for me. And essentially, your body responding that, yes, this is better, I have more energy. The mood enhancement can also come with that placebo effect, and the better dispersion of calories throughout the day. So there's many reasons why there may be just more energy, and also the reduction of carbohydrates may also lead to the utilization of fat. And we know carbohydrates are 4 calories per gram. We know fats are 9 calories. So we're getting over 2 times as many calories in a fat gram than we are a carbohydrate gram. So maybe the body goes through some type of shift and utilizes more fat for fuel source. And that's where we get into ketones and the next diet we'll be talking about. So there are possibilities for more energy. Unfortunately, it's hard to decipher which reason that person may be getting quote unquote more energy without actually doing muscle biopsies and microdialysis and different rather invasive reasons. The levels of serotonin may play a part in increased quote unquote feel good response as the body makes those changes, increased mood or better mood, better diet overall. So that placebo effect of I'm eating better, so I must have more energy, I must be better. Enhanced exercise and the response to exercise, so the recovery period and the recovery piece. So a lot of variables. Unfortunately, none can actually determine that this is the reason why this person has more energy without doing those specific scientific tests. It may or may not be beneficial for performance, and we've seen a lot of people, if you look at a lot of the CrossFitters, they can perform very well eating specific diets. And some of them do follow a paleo diet. Some of them do follow just a general higher carbohydrate diet for that fuel source. Depending on who you follow or any other specific CrossFitter that you know, some benefit, some don't. And it comes to the training, it comes to the timing, it comes to the overall calorie, micronutrient, macronutrient distribution. There's a lot of variables that play into effect. So a one-size-fits-all diet should never be considered the best diet for that particular sport or event. And also aesthetic and body composition changes. As always, it's always the worst answer, but it's always the most true answer. More studies are needed. We really need to see better studies with paleo and especially CrossFit to see, get a better honing and idea of how this diet affects performance over a long term, and will that performance consistently increase while health is maintained or improved? So here's a sample meal plan from US News Health. That's about a 2,200 calorie meal plan. So a typical for somebody who's relatively athletic and fit, a typical day of just kind of lounging and maybe walking around and doing their normal job throughout the day, a very relatively light day. You can see if you look down and read that there really isn't a heavy amount of carbohydrates in this diet. The carbohydrates that this menu that this meal plan is providing is really coming from the fruit and some of the vegetables. And some of these vegetables have so little carbohydrates and calories in them that some of them are considered relatively free foods, quote unquote free foods, where there's probably approximately 5 to 25 total calories in that amount, where we may burn 5 to 20, 25 calories just actually chewing and breaking down that food rather than actually consuming them. So some of those foods are actually considered free foods, where the amount that energy that it takes to break it down is relative to the amount of energy that it's providing. So if you look at this, this may be a very tough meal plan for a lot of people to follow initially because it takes away a lot of the foods that we do like. We don't see any pasta on here. We don't see any breads, even whole grain, multi-grain, whole wheat breads. We don't see any whole grain rice. So a lot of things that we like to eat that think are extremely healthy aren't even on here. So, and a lot of those foods are relatively cheap. A loaf of bread is $2 to $3. A box of brown rice is a price $1 to $1.50. So these diets can potentially, not all the time, but can be a little bit more expensive because a lot of the stuff is fresh, and if you're not getting in season fresh food, you're going to pay more for it. The meats we know are usually the most expensive part because it's an animal product. So this diet can be expensive for some people to maintain, and that is also not a good diet if we're unable to sustain it financially. So what it gets right in the terms of its advocates and the overall aspect of the diet itself, it really does emphasize lean proteins, whole fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds, healthy fats, which if you talk to any dietitian, any nutritionist, really any personal trainer, anybody who has common sense about basic nutrition, and you're just a general healthy individual looking to improve your performance and just general health, those would be the answers that they would give you. Better lean proteins rather than fatty proteins, whole fruits and vegetables rather than processed, dried, sugary fruit juices and pureed vegetable and fruit, sugar smoothies, and of course, nuts and seeds rather than trail mix covered in chocolate. And so, of course, that's a very simple thing to say, and the paleo diet does emphasize those things. It can be more satiating, so basically fills us up, makes us feel fuller longer. And that's usually due to higher protein consumption and the healthier fats, which slow down digestion, make us feel fuller longer, keeps a lot of that food in our stomach a little bit longer, slows down the digestion and absorption of the food and liquids, and doesn't give us that feeling that we have to eat again. It's potentially effective for reducing the onset of certain disease and reducing the risk markers for certain diseases, reducing insulin secretion, increased insulin sensitivity. So, improving the sensitivity to insulin, not necessarily having to force more insulin to have the same effect, which is a bad thing if our body constantly is forcing more insulin and that insulin, and eventually the pancreas cannot produce the insulin, the beta cells shut down, and we don't have that response anymore. That is type 2 diabetes. So increased insulin sensitivity is a benefit for us, and the paleo diet can offer that potentially. Potential reduction in LDLs, what we know as quote unquote the bad cholesterol, and decreased blood pressure, and increase awareness of the food production. So we see a lot of paleo diet does emphasize raw, whole, natural, organic, unprocessed food. So that forces us to have to be more knowledgeable and more food conscious about where our food's produced, where we're getting it, how it's being processed. And really, that's a good thing. If we look down, we just need to know more about what is actually going into our mouth and how it's affecting us, and how nutrient dense these foods really are, and is it a benefit to consume it. So, yes, these things we can say that the paleo diet does get right, but really every diet should get that right. Every diet should have these things in it. What the paleo diet may not do as well as other diets or as a good just general meal plan, and some people say what it gets wrong is its reasoning for excluding dairy, legumes, and grains. A lot of the research today doesn't have strong correlation with excluding dairy, legumes, and grains leads to better performance or health. So the evidence is weak right now for excluding dairy, legumes, and grains and other things. We can miss different micronutrients and minerals like fiber. If we're reducing carbohydrates, fiber's heavy in pastas and grains and fortified foods. Potassium, calcium, vitamin B12 and D, so very, very necessary micronutrients that are utilized, that utilize proteins, fats, and carbohydrates for energy. So we need the B vitamins, we need calcium for bone health and bone density, we need vitamin D for processing of cholesterol and its benefits and performance, potential benefits in actual performance and health. There haven't been really any long-term studies. Some of the longest have been up to 12 weeks, but a diet that lasts 12 weeks is good for those maybe short-term reasons, but we need to see actually long-term effects on overall health. And we just don't have those yet. So we don't know after, really after 12 weeks, after a few months, how the paleo diet is affecting us. The evolutionary argument, again, we don't know if the caveman diet is the best diet because we don't know any cavemen. We are not cavemen, and very few of us actually go hunt for our food. So we don't have that ability to kind of say, this is exactly how they ate. The strict food rules is really tough for a lot of people, reduces the margin of error. So if it's an accident, we pick a certain food, we've deviated from that diet, and it may be a psychological effect on some people where we're unable to maintain this diet, so we're failing. And that constant negative aspect doesn't help the next diet, doesn't help that person overcome whatever obstacle they're doing. So that smaller margin of error and those restrictions, it makes it much harder for somebody who's susceptible to being depressed due to failing at this diet or being discouraged is a negative thing. And we want to discourage people having to have those small margin of errors. And for some people, it really can be expensive, depending on where you live, your socioeconomic status, the restricted access, depending on if you have a car, if you're able to get these specific foods, how expensive it is. So we really do have to take in those things into effect. Leslie Bonsi, she's director of sports nutrition at UPMC, University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. Excellent registered dietitian, sports dietitian. This is taken from her. You can actually, there's the link up there if you ever want to look her up and read some of the stuff that she writes about different nutrition for athletes. She works with the Pittsburgh Steelers and Pirates and other various teams and professional athletes. So these are her general observations about the pros and cons of paleo. And I will say a good dietitian always sees both sides, always sees the pros and cons, and never makes an absolute statement. And she does a very good job with that. Just a few things. The diet is higher in protein. So we know that's important to rebuild and maintain the muscle. That's very metabolic for us, and improves our health. The more muscle we have, the healthier we can be. But unfortunately, too much protein, and this is where if we reduce one macronutrient too much, the other one has to come, another one may have to come into play. And too much protein may lead to too little carbohydrate. And we know that's the energy source for exercise, especially hard, heavy, intense exercise. And for athletes, and we really consider athletes, not just Olympians or professional football players, but anybody who just wants to perform better. Someone who likes to go out and play with their kids, or maybe goes out playing golf with their friends on the weekends. Really, if you're performing in a sport in any way, you can consider yourself an athlete. So the amount of carbs maybe just be too low for those athletes to perform their event well. And it's a very restrictive diet for some people. Benefits that she writes about: the clean diet without the additives, preservatives, chemicals, depending on how liberal you are with the paleo diet. The anti-inflammatory benefits from those plant nutrients, which we know are very nutrient dense and provide a lot of those antioxidant properties, anti-inflammatory properties. The vegetables, the healthy oils, nuts, and seeds. Increased red meat intake because of the increased protein and the lean meats and fish may lead to better iron intake. And for some women, this is a important thing. Women tend to have iron issues more so than men, and so actually intaking iron through this red meat can be beneficial. Improved satiety, of course, that feeling of fullness. And most people are going to lose weight assuming their exercise increases, stays the same without reducing, and you plan out the diet appropriately for your activity level and your normal life, depending on if you want to lose weight. But you said primarily due to limited food choice, and if you're restricted to only these things, you can only eat so much of them. So sometimes you eat just overall less, and less calories in, more calories out, weight loss. Some of the risks and disadvantages: it can be pricey, as we've talked about. Having to consistently always buy meat and cook the meat can just be, unfortunately, very expensive for some of us. No dairy is not great for bone health and restructuring. We know calcium helps refortify bones, helps build it. Vitamin D and calcium work very closely. So if we have a, if we're deficient or insufficient with vitamin D and calcium, the risk of osteoporosis, osteopenia, bone breaks are increased as we get older, and especially women. Taking away foods and nutrients You can create nutrient imbalances, and these just, we never feel, oh, I'm nutrient imbalanced right now. But those are the long-term effects that we don't want to happen. We don't want to see nutrient imbalances because long-term nutrient imbalance leads to detrimental effects later on that unfortunately then we will just have to deal with or backtrack. Hard for vegetarians sometimes because, as we know, they don't eat meat. So to have to intake lean meats and fish or get that protein necessary is even a more of a restriction. So that puts a lot of stress on vegetarians and vegans, where we are furthering the and enhancing the restrictions already on top of the restrictions. And some research shows that athletes need between 3 to 6, it's been as high as 12 grams of carbs per kilogram, roughly 6 grams of carbs per pound on their body weight. And to get that amount of carbohydrates on the paleo diet is very difficult with just fruits and vegetables. They'd have to overconsume a lot of fruits and vegetables, which unfortunately may mean overconsumption of calories. This is a study done on the paleo. There's been many done, but we just pulled one. It's from the European Journal of Clinical Nutrition. The background is essentially how a paleo diet confers with benefits on health, and whether the diet actually has any health benefits based on what we believe our ancestors ate. They used 9 non-obese sedentary individuals with no weight loss on a daily basis. So they maintained the weight. What they did was a normal diet for 3 days, just a normal regular diet. Then they did 3 ramp-up diets. Essentially, to increase their potassium and fiber for 7 days, and then they went on a paleo diet, basically eating lean meats, fruits, vegetables, and nuts, and excluding all the non-paleo foods for 10 days. So, 3, 7, 10. What they saw was they did a bunch of different tests using area under the curve, the AUC, blood pressure, oral glucose tolerance test, insulin sensitivity. Plasma lipid concentration, so essentially fat. And what they found was on the diet, the improved arterial distensibility, significant reduction in plasma insulin. So again, reduction in that insulin that was being pushed through the beta cells and utilized. So we don't have that over production of insulin because insulin leads to fat storage. And over amounts of insulin over long term can lead to essentially insulin resistance. Large significant reduction in total cholesterol, low density lipoproteins, LDL, and triglycerides. So, according to this study, even though it was short term, roughly 2 weeks, and only 9 people, they determined that a short term consumption of the paleo type diet improves blood pressure, glucose, decreased insulin secretion, increased insulin sensitivity, which we said was a good thing, improved lipid profile, so lower LDL and triglyceride levels without the weight loss. So again, one study, small sample size, showed promising things, promising results, but much more studies are needed to see how long term this will affect people. Some of the possible changes that if people don't want to go on a paleo diet but still like the idea of changing up some things and maybe being a little bit more liberal on their paleo diet, kind of a quasi-paleo, Dr. John Berardi from Precision Nutrition recommends these things. And these are really great simple examples and things that you can change very simply to get more towards a paleo, but maybe not go strict on saying I am going paleo if you like some of the ideas that paleo has. And one is that is eat a little bit more fresh food, try to remove some of the processed juices and sugars and drinks and things and replacing them with a fresh fruit or fresh vegetables rather than canned or a puree or a mix. To dinner or lunch or anything like that. So those small changes are very easy to do and can potentially lead to better and greater benefits. Replacing a bit of the processed food, not recommending that replace all at once, going to those absolutes really may not have any benefit and may just psychologically restrict you and cause people to withdraw from it. So replacing little by little the processed foods leads to better outcomes and long-term sustainability. And some of the smaller things that people don't understand, going outside just for fresh air, getting moving, removing yourself from food temptation and actually enjoying it and increasing that metabolic rate through actual movement and getting a good night's sleep. We've seen a lot of research that shows overconsumption of processed foods has affected sleep, and having poor night's sleep causes people to overconsume higher sugar, higher overprocessed foods, which then just further exacerbates poor sleep, poor health habits, increased rate of obesity, and just catapults us into that negative spiral. So better good night's sleep, overall better health. We're going to finish up with the ketogenic diet, low carb, high fat, LCHF. What is it really? Some people just call it a low-carb diet, and really the paleo diet can be considered a low-carb diet. The Atkins diet can be considered a low-carb diet. The ketogenic diet is a little bit different. It is a low-carb, high-fat, not low-fat, high-carb, low-carb, high-fat diet. So we'll say that again, low-carb, high-fat diet. So it again is a low-carb diet, higher in fat specifically, rather than paleo and others are higher in proteins, higher in healthier fats. The ketogenic diet is a lower-carb, higher-fat diet, and the whole point of it is the body to produce ketones and the liver to be used as energy. And there's different molecules that are considered ketones. Ketones is the overarching name for some of these molecules and substrates to be used. But in 1924, Dr. Russell Wilder at the Mayo Clinic essentially devised and designed this specific diet. It was highly effective at actually treating epilepsy and seizures. And then around 30s and 40s and so forth, better drugs came out, and it was easier for people to take a pill or a drug rather than change their dietary changes. Typical. The Charlie Foundation, 1994, was named for Charlie Abraham. He was consistently suffering from seizures as a small child, went through a brain surgery, which unfortunately had no true positive effect. So they went on this diet for 5 years, essentially the ketogenic diet, started as a toddler, and is now completely recovered from daily seizures. And I believe the studies and on this individual and some of the information, he is a college student or if not past college now. So the Charlie Foundation was formed to really hone in on what the ketogenic diet is and what it does. So again, it's high in fat, low in carb, adequate protein, and it's supposed to change how the energy is utilized in the body. So this is a little bit different than the paleo with specific reasons why. The fat that is consumed is converted to fatty acids and ketones in the body, mostly through the liver. The ketones are then utilized rather than other energy substrates like glucose and proteins as the energy substrate, which go in through the blood, and that whole process is called ketosis. So using ketones as our main substrate for energy, we would potentially see a lower glucose level and improved insulin resistance, so increased insulin sensitivity, decreased essentially insulin resistance, so it's improvement in that, and increased insulin sensitivity. We want to see that insulin sensitivity increase, which means we don't need as much insulin to have the same effect. So those lower glucose levels can help reduce those onsets of type 2 diabetes and those markers of type 2 diabetes and, of course, obesity and other detrimental diseases. It's been mainstreamed to aid in different performance effects like body composition. We've actually seen some professional athletes use a ketogenic diet for athletic performance and other health attributes. So like reduced cholesterol, blood pressure, triacylglycerides, which are triglycerides, and other things. So a lot of we're seeing more and more professional athletes and celebrity athletes kind of going on these ketogenic diets, not because they have epilepsy or seizures, but they are seeing potential benefits in their performance because of this diet. And again, this goes back to, is it because they are actually utilizing fat as an energy source now, where again, it's 9 calories per gram, so we can get more energy from the same amount of fat than we can get a carb. Have they made that change? Is it a placebo effect? Is it the perceived idea of eating better, feeling better? So there's a lot of variables to play into account in some of these individuals. And this is from the Charlie Foundation, and they go over the reasons of the ketogenic diet, questions, how it's formulated, and they compare it to a modified Atkins, a low glycemic diet, an MCT oil, medium chain triglyceride oil. And if you look where it says how much carbohydrate is allowed on a 1,000-calorie diet, there are different ratios. What is the ratio of fat to carb and protein? 4:1, 3:1, 2:1, and 1:1. They're basically saying for every gram of carbohydrate and protein combined, there are 4 grams of fat. Same thing with the 3:1. For every 1:1 combined, there's 3 grams of fat. The 2:1 and the 1:1 are the little bit more liberal ketogenic diets. There are different ones, as you can see, varying how much carbohydrate is to be taken in and consumed, but again, it is a lower carb one, higher fat diet predominantly. If you look at the whole scheme, and of course this is not absolute, these numbers reflect different people. Those numbers can be lower than 70, higher than 75 for fat, different for protein, of course different for carbs, but in general we see that carbohydrate for us as Americans is usually around 60 to 65% intake. We're seeing almost a complete flip where fat is almost 3/4 of the macronutrient intake on a daily basis, where carbs are anywhere between 5 to 10% of an intake, and they really try to stay with less than 60 grams per day. And that's just at least to help maintain brain function, because the brain functions on glucose and ketones. And this 5 to 10%, less than 60 grams, comes from varying sources of carbohydrates. So 5 to 10 grams of fruit, different vegetables, protein 15 to 20%, so right around normal range for protein, but really that flip-flop of much higher increase in fat intake and lower carbohydrate, very low carbohydrate intake throughout the day. And this can be really psychologically difficult for people to consume 60 grams. Essentially, that's maybe 3 to 4 slices of a very hearty bread a day, and that would be it for carbohydrates. So just your breakfast may be 50% of your carbohydrates for that day, and there can be nothing else. So again, it can be very difficult to maintain this diet, but there are some potential benefits to it. Some have been the increases in the body's ability to the ability and or need to utilize fats for fuel. Not necessarily just the ability, because not everybody can actually make that shift or make that change as theoretically possible, but it may also be the need to utilize the fats where the body is being starved of carbohydrates and it doesn't necessarily want to, but it has to just to maintain existing and being alive, utilize those fats as a fuel source. Ketosis has seemed to have a bit of a protein sparing effect, under the assumption that you are consuming adequate quantities of protein, at least 0.8 grams per kilogram for a normal individual, and of course probably a little bit more, maybe up to 1.2 to 1.7 grams for a higher end athlete, which may mean carbohydrates and fats have to be changed around to stay in that 70 to 75% fat range, 5 to 10% carbohydrate range, and 15 to 20% protein range. Again, like I said before, depending on how liberal and free you are with the ketogenic diet, those increases and decreases may need to take into effect and will affect the other two macronutrients. So it has to be planned very cautiously, very precisely. And that's these ketogenic diets given to people specifically for health and medical reasons are usually done exclusively through registered dietitians and doctors who have had experience and knowledge and the background to do this. And these are usually administered in hospitals. For people who are looking for performance reasons, they essentially just try to reduce carbohydrates and increase fat intake as much as possible. The low levels of insulin in the body due to the low carbohydrate and response, because of the low glucose and starches intake, because of the low carbs and reduction, only 5 to 10%. Low levels can actually the low levels of insulin actually lead to a greater lipolysis, so breakdown of fat, and the free glycerol release compared to a normal diet. So lipolysis is the breaking of the fat, and then beta oxidation would be the utilization of fat. So the lower levels of insulin, higher ketones, for energy, we see the breaking of the fat for the energy, which is lipolysis, and then the utilization of the fat molecules, the beta oxidation, as the energy source. And when we have increased amounts of insulin surging, that leads to greater fat storage. So one of the benefits of a ketogenic diet is if we have lower levels of insulin, we will have less fat storage, more utilization of that fat for energy, and hopefully better outcomes and better performance. Because predominantly, there's a lot of fat in all individuals that can theoretically be utilized as energy, which could last a long, long time, rather than the carbohydrates that we have in our body, which could last maybe just up to a few hours. In the state of ketosis, ketones, and with a high protein intake help to suppress the appetite, so help to feel full, that satiating effect. Because again, fat is 9 calories per gram, and it slows down digestion. So the longer time that food sits in us, the slower digestion, the more full we feel, suppress our appetite, potentially eat less. So again, if we're looking for a calorie restriction, this is one of the potential benefits of a ketogenic diet. One of the pitfalls, or some of the pitfalls, Dr. Mauro de Pascal says during the first few weeks, the body goes through what he terms as a metabolic shift. And that shift, he states, people can go through fatigue, a brain fog, kind of feeling just under the weather, not being able to perceive the normal routine that they normally can't, that they normally do on a regular diet. Maybe slower response to certain things, and dehydration actually, because with carbohydrates and glycogen comes a water storage. And if we have a reduction in glycogen storage, a reduction in carbohydrates, we see a reduction in water storage, which can lead to dehydration as well. Blood lipid profiles can be disrupted, so we need to see more studies how this actually affects our blood lipid panels, our LDLs, HDLs, cholesterol, triglycerides, because we are increasing the fat that we've consumed. And some studies have come out saying increased fat does not affect these, but is that increased healthy fats, monounsaturated, polyunsaturated, or is that just increased overall fats, including saturated fats, trans fats, hydrogenated oils? So really we need to know a little bit more of, yes, we're consuming much more fat, but is that, are those healthy fats? Are those necessary fats? Can we utilize those fats as energy? A lot of necessary micronutrients and/or minerals that we get through carbohydrates, pastas, grains, breads, may be insufficient, deficient, non-existent in a ketogenic diet. So there may be a need for supplements. Thiamine, folate, calcium, iron, potassium, magnesium are some of the ones that predominantly we see reduced at an insufficient level. Or at an impaired level in ketogenic diet. So there may be a need for supplementation for some of these to maintain overall health and overall metabolic balance. The low carb, high fat diet tends to be lower in calories just because of the higher fat intake, the reduced or the suppressed appetite, and just overall potential, again, restriction in food choices may lead to overall lower caloric intake. With every reduced calorie diet, and this can potentially be one of them, may not always be. There's going to be a negative energy balance. And one of the things that people on a ketogenic diet have to be aware of is that if that person is not consuming enough protein to maintain or enhance muscle repair and rebuilding, the body can't potentially use that muscle and those proteins as substrates for energy. So we may not just see weight loss, we also may see muscle mass loss and decreased performance. So that may lead us to inadvertently overconsume more proteins to make up for that loss, which then may lead to increased overall caloric intake, which then may lead to increased weight. So there is an art and a science to these type of diets where there is a very specific range that needs to be maintained based on our exercise level, intensity level, and changes in body composition over time. So the diet does have to change with as the body changes. And a lot of people don't change that. As their body becomes healthier and more fit, their diet stays the same and they don't see the results they want. So there is an art, there is a science, and people need to know how to do those. Just from Forsyth in 2008, they did this over 3 months and 40 subjects through metabolic syndrome. We're not going to get specifically into that. They were either a low carb or low fat diet. So the ketogenic diet in red and just a low fat diet in blue. So there is a difference between a low fat and ketogenic diet. So they compare the differences, and we'll just go over a few. Body mass, we can see that there was a re much greater reduction in body mass in the ketogenic diet than low fat. Triglycerides, a much greater reduction in triglyceride percent change than just in the low fat. HDL, we saw a increased percent change. So that means higher HDL levels, which are the quote unquote good cholesterol. And in the low fat, we saw a lowering, a slight lowering of the HDL. So again, that could just be because of the sample size they had, but the ketogenic diet saw an increase in the HDL. If we look at glucose, GLU, we see that it has decreased. The percent decrease compared to low fat was greater. Insulin, greater in ketogenic diets. The percent decreased, 60%. Rather than compared to 30%, so almost a double on the ketogenic diet. So a lot of good benefits from the ketogenic diet compared to a low-fat diet. But again, 3 months, 40 subjects, just comparing these two diets. So we really need to see much more robust studies and reasonings. Tim Olson in 2012 and 2013 won the Western States 100 Mile, so it's a 100-mile run. As you can see, he did it in 14 hours and 46 minutes and won 15 hours and 17 minutes. And he follows the ketogenic diet, or at least a version of it. And some people say, well, it's a diet high in fat and low in carbs. There's no way somebody can be able to perform at that in that level. But here's one advocate and one performer on a ketogenic, higher fat, lower carb diet that has won it back to back with incredible time. So, one reason why a lot of people advocate for this diet. Dr. Jeff Volek, an incredible PhD and actually registered dietitian, does a lot of talks and discussions with low carbohydrate, high fat diet, ketogenic diet. And here's just a day one sample that he has taken. This is actually less than 50 grams of carbohydrates. And it's roughly 2,500 kcal. So depending on your day, depending on how many kcal you would need, here's a good range or idea of how the meal plan on one day would look based on a ketogenic diet. And if you look at the pictures, it's really not that crazy of a diet. Seems to be a lot of vegetables and different types of fruits, and maybe a little bit more than some people would normally eat in one sitting. But some people do get used to this type of food pattern and palate, and it can be beneficial, it can be detrimental. It really just depends on the individual and what the doctor and dietitian say that is necessary for that particular person. Some of the changes, if you want to see in a low carb, high fat diet, consider slowly changing. Sometimes going from one extreme to another, going from 60% of your carbs to all of a sudden 5% can be very drastic and really unsustainable. Very few people can maintain that. So some people recommend every week or so reducing it 5% and then increasing carb fat 5%. But remember, If you decrease carbohydrates 5% 1 week and increase fat 5% that same week, it is not a one-to-one. So you cannot decrease 5% of carbs, and let's just say that happens to be 50 grams. You cannot consume 50 grams of fat, because fat is 9 calories while carbs are 4, so they're over twice as calorie dense as carbohydrates. So it is not a one-to-one switch. So it may be percentage-wise, but it's primarily going to be half the amount of grams, if not a little bit less than half, because it's over twice as much, you know, twice as calorie dense than carbohydrates. So make sure that if you ever were to experiment, you are not making a one-to-one switch. Percentage-wise, yes, but not for gram-wise. After a few weeks, people recommend then 5 to 10% in the next 2 weeks, and doing that step-by-step drop of 5 to 10% to where there's a limit of this is where you can maintain your performance at that particular optimum carbohydrate fat intake. So may not have to go dramatically to 5 to 10% like that previous slide showed, and up to 75% fat. There may be a range that may be a little bit more better for you, maybe a little bit more liberal on the ketogenic diet as it is stated. So in summary, always before starting any particular diet plan, you have to consult your doctor and dietitian. There are some diets that are very detrimental and very beneficial, but depending on your status, you just don't know how it's going to affect whether you're taking medication, whether you've had surgery, pre-surgery, any metabolic diseases, any risk factors that are in your family that are genetic. You should be consulting with your doctor to make sure you are doing, and registered dietitian to make sure you are most knowledgeable on what is necessary for you. The best diet is, unfortunately, there is no particular diet that will fit you specifically that was on this sheet. There has to be some modifications that are going to fit you. So really the best diet is one that is energy balanced, one that is nutrient dense, one that is overall going to be a health advocate, achieve good health, achieve positive body composition and or your performance goals, one that is outcome-based, so we know that there's research, we know that there is a reason behind this diet that is going to provide this, and of course one that's sustainable. It's financially sustainable, it's economically sustainable, it's longevity, and you can utilize it for a long time, it's enjoyable, it's economically sustainable. And you have to look at your current situation and goals, and of course the short and long term. What is going to be necessary to make those changes? Is it going to be financially? Is it going to be spiritually? Is it going to be time? Is it going to be a drastic change in intake and foregoing the enjoyment of food, which of course we don't want ever want to see? Do the risks of this particular diet outweigh the benefits? If they do, can we really consider that a good diet? Should that be really taken into account? So you have to weigh out the pros and cons and what's beneficial for you and what's going to be the best choice for you at that moment. And, of course, long-term. Short-term, long-term results. What is that particular goal? You may be trying to get ready for a competition or try to fit into a specific outfit for a specific reason in a few months, but can you maintain that long term? Should this be maintained long term? And are you completely informed? Don't go based off of what you see just on TV or what celebrities or what one study has done. Locate all the studies and locate all the research that shows this study works, this study doesn't work. This study worked for these people, this study didn't work for these people. Get both ends of the research and make the most informed decision possible based on what you know about yourself, what you know about the studies, and how they affect you. I hope you enjoyed this. We went over just a little bit, but again, if you have any questions, please feel free to send them in. We'll be glad to answer them as best as possible. We're going to do this again in the next for the next month and the next few months coming up after that. So if you have any suggestions on topics you guys want to talk about, please feel free to send them in, and we will definitely try to hit them in next lectures. So thanks for your time, and have a good evening.